morning and welcome for joining us on this bright sunny service after the big snowfall. We need the snow, but we sure need the sunshine too. Would you please join us in the call to worship? When I waited patiently for you, O God, you bent down to me and heard my cry. You put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. I have told the glad news of deliverance in the great congregation. I have not restrained my lips, as you know, O Lord.
Do not, O Lord, withhold your mercy from me. Let your steadfast love and faithfulness keep me safe forever.
Let us worship God.
You have called us before we were born, O God, and named us in our mother's womb. You have made our mouths like sharp swords and hid us in the shadow of your hand. You have made us polished arrows and kept us safe in your quiver. In Christ, you have called us to be your servants, to be a light to the nations, and to herald your goodness to all. Now our heads are lifted up, and we will offer you our sacrifices with shouts of joy.
Please join us in the hymn on page 401. Join me in the prayer of confession. Our desire is to do your will, O God. Your law is in our hearts. But when misfortunes beyond counting press from all sides and iniquities overtake us, our sight fails. When we are tempted by the vain promises of a life full of ease, our courage forsakes us and we submit to their claim. When enemies overpower us and mock our faith, we shrink back in disgrace and abandon what Christ taught. O God, we are poor and in need. You are our help and salvation. Come to our aid and make no delay.
Yeah, I know. Grace and peace is given to you in Jesus Christ. All who call upon his name, he claims as his own. God will keep you firm to the end, without reproach, on the day of our Lord Jesus. It is God who called you to share in the life of God's Son, Jesus Christ. God keeps faith and forgives our sins. God be with you.
And also with you.
Greet one another in peace.
I'd like to see the kids who are here come on down. I think there's a big hockey tournament this weekend. Isn't this cabin fever?
Yes.
Yes, that must be where everybody is. That's what I'm going to go with. They didn't just stay home. Well, good morning to two of my favorite young ladies. How are you guys? Good, good. What do you think of all this snow? Good, yeah, you still like it, don't you? Well, Mark and I were a little late getting here because the plow guy came through just as we were getting ready to leave. And they always think it's funny to give us about 3 feet of snow in front of our driveway. So in our Sunday best, we shoveled our driveway. So we were running a little late today. But I can see why when you're young, you still think the snow's pretty terrific. Well, I wanted you to think about, how do you know what's going on in the world? How do you know these things? Like, how do we know what's going on in France? Or what's going on in Mexico? Or how do we know what's going on in Russia? How do we know these things? Because we know them. How do you suppose your moms and dads know what's going on all over the world? A map helps, you bet. A map helps. Where do you think? Where do we get our information from? The news. There's an eyewitness account of so many things. People see what's going on and they report it either on the news or on the radio or on Facebook or on Twitter or any of these other forms of social media. The news, but somebody has witnessed it and seen the news either in real life or they've seen it from the satellites, but somebody has seen what's going on and they've taken it upon themselves to share that news. Well, in Jesus' day, there wasn't Facebook, and there wasn't television, and there wasn't radio. Everything was dependent on what people saw, them telling each other by word of mouth. They had to tell them. So when John the Baptist experienced Jesus, he went out and he told other people. He was what we call an eyewitness. He saw it with his eye, so he witnessed it, and he went forth and told other people about Jesus. And today we read a lot about Jesus on the internet, and we have television programs about Jesus and books about Jesus, and I think there's probably a Twitter account that somebody runs who says they're Jesus. There's something every day for us to learn about Jesus. But how people really come to know Jesus is from the eyewitnesses. It's from people like you guys and like us who experience Jesus every day in our lives and see with our own eyes the good thing that God has done, and then we share it with others. We tell them about it, just like John the Baptist did. So while things might have changed since John the Baptist was around 2,000 years ago, really they haven't. Spreading the good news of the gospel is still dependent on people like you and me sharing the good news, using our mouths to spread it. Think you guys could do that? Tell people about Jesus and how much he loves them? That's great. Let us pray. God, whilst we notice that times have changed and technology has in some ways made life so very different, we are grateful that the basics remain, that your love and your faith and your forgiveness and your grace and your mercy are everlasting. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, let's go to Sunday school.
Seated. First scripture text today comes from Isaiah chapter 49, starting at verse 1. Listen to me, O coastlands. Pay attention, you peoples from far away. The Lord called me before I was born. While I was in my mother's womb, he named me. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver, he hid me away. And he said to me, you are my servant, Israel, in whom I will be glorified. But I said, I have looked in vain at my labor. I have spent my strength for nothing in vanity. Yet surely my cause is with the Lord, and my reward is with my God. And now the Lord says, who formed me in the womb to be a servant, to bring Jacob back to him, and that Israel might be gathered to him. For I am honored in the sight of the Lord, and my God has become my strength. He says, is it too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel? I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and his Holy One, to one deeply despised, abhorred by the nations, the slaves of rulers. Kings shall see and stand up, princes, and they shall prostrate themselves, because the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, has chosen you. Our New Testament lesson today comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, starting at verse 1. Paul called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those who in every place call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that you have given to us in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge, in every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Our gospel text today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, starting at verse 29. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descend from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus and looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which translated is Peter. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before the days of the internet, people would listen to songs and they'd hear the lyrics of songs, but sometimes they wouldn't quite hear them accurately. And so I have a few examples of the most common comprehension fails for song lyrics. There was a band by the name of Dire Straits, and the correct line in their song was, "Money for nothing and your chicks for free." And people heard that as money for nothing and your chips for free. Paul Young's song, the correct line is, "Every time you go away, you take a piece of me with you." And people heard that, "Every time you go away, you take a piece of meat with you." Starship's song, where the correct lyric is, "We built this city on rock and roll." Some heard that, "We built the city on sausage rolls." ABBA's lyrics from Dancing Queen, the correct lyric, "See that girl, watch that scene, dig in the Dancing Queen." Obviously during the days of, but people heard, "See that girl, watch her scream, kicking the Dancing Queen." That's a far different song. Jimi Hendrix's classic Purple Haze, correct line is, "Excuse me while I kiss the sky." People heard, "Excuse me while I kiss this guy." Dancing Queen again confused people. Another one of their lyrics was, "Dancing Queen, feel the beat from the tambourine." And people heard that, "Dancing Queen, feel the beat from the tangerine." The Eurythmics' Sweet Dreams, the correct line is, "Sweet dreams are made of these." And people heard, "Sweet dreams are made of cheese." Johnny Nash's song, the correct line, "I can see clearly now, the rain is gone." Some people heard that, "I can see clearly now, Lorraine is gone." And then finally, the Monkees, "I'm a Believer." The correct line, of course, is, "Then I saw her face, and now I'm a believer." And people heard that as, "Now I see her face, now I'm going to leave her." Much different song. Sometimes it's funny when we don't quite understand what we're hearing. Sometimes that happens because we just simply don't hear it. Other times that happens because we're thinking about something and then someone talks to us and somehow our brain mixes that all up. Just yesterday I was thinking about the church and Melissa asked me a question and I kept hearing her ask about session and it wasn't making any sense. And finally, after asking her what she said a couple times, she was using the word obsession. And of course I was hearing it as session because my brain was thinking about the church. Sometimes we don't hear correctly because we're thinking about something else that someone is not asking us about. And yet there are times that there are differences just because the human experience, it's unique to each individual. There's a subjective quality to it. There can be an event that happens and 10 different people can have 10 different stories about that event. Some of the things will be the same, but a lot of the details will be very, very different. And sometimes you wonder, were the two people even at the same event? In our gospel lesson today, in John's gospel, he has his version of John the Baptist. And in his version of John the Baptist is out there and he's preaching and he's baptizing people in the River Jordan and they're confessing their sins to him. And he's telling people that there's one who's going to come after him. He's very clear, "I'm not the Messiah." He says, "There's one who's coming after me who is greater than I am." And he calls this person the Lamb of God who's going to take away the sins of the world. And he also tells the people that he's going to be the one to give us the Holy Spirit. Two of John's disciples, who would become the Apostle Andrew and the Apostle John, were listening to John the Baptist one day preach and teach. And they see Jesus coming. And John points him out. And he says, "This is the Lamb of God." And so Andrew and John stop following John the Baptist and they start following Jesus. When Jesus sees them following, he turns around and says, "What are you looking for?" And they say, "Rabbi, teacher, where are you staying?" Which is basically a polite way of saying, "Can we join you?" And Jesus says, "Come and see," which was a way of saying, "Yes, come and join me." Now, after they met Jesus and after hearing about what John the Baptist said about Jesus, they were so excited that they went and they got their brothers. Andrew went and got his brother Peter, and that's how Peter, the rock on which the church was built, was introduced to Jesus. And John, the apostle, went and got his brother James, and that's how James came to meet Jesus. And so James and John and Peter, you call them the ranking members of the apostles, came to Jesus in our gospel lesson today. One of the very interesting things I find about this gospel story is how different it is for the story of John the Baptist we have in the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. There are a lot of similarities, of course. John's out there in the wilderness, and he's baptizing, and people are confessing their sins, and he's telling them, I'm not the Messiah, and there's one who's coming after me who is greater. There's a lot of similarities, but boy, are there a lot of differences. In the other ones, John is shouting, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath, and bear fruit that befits repentance, because God can take stones and raise up children to Abraham from these stones. The axe is already laid to the tree. He's got his winnowing fork in his hand. He's going to gather the grain in his barn, and the chaff he's going to burn with unquenchable fire. My gosh, if you listen to the other synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, about John the Baptist, you understand why almost every movie representation of John the Baptist, almost every TV representation, he seems to be like a good Baptist preacher at a tent revival, saving people's souls so they don't go to the lake of fire. John's version of John the Baptist is completely different. He's not yelling at anybody. He's not yelling at the crowds. He's not yelling at the Pharisees. He's not yelling at the Romans. And John's out there humbly teaching people about what the Messiah is going to be. And this is where the real difference is. It's not just the yelling. It's just not the characterization of John the Baptist being so different. It's actually what he said. In John's gospel, he has John the Baptist telling us what kind of Messiah Jesus is going to be. The Lamb of God who would take away the sin of the world. And that's actually an amazing difference between the synoptics and John's gospel. Why was it amazing? Because if you look at the titles of the Messiah in the Old Testament, if you look at all the various titles for the Messiah, you do not find Lamb of God as a potential title of the Messiah. There's all sorts of other titles for him. The Lion of the Tribe of Judea, the Righteous One, the Branch, God. There's all sorts of amazing titles for the Messiah. And with those go all sorts of prophecies about how the Messiah is going to come, use the power of God, going to put down evil in the world, and institute the reign of God in the world. And of course, that's what everyone was excited about. That's the Messiah everyone was looking for. That's the Messiah that everyone was talking about. That's the one they were hoping John was, and that's the one they were hoping John was proclaiming. And according to the Synoptic Gospels, it looks like maybe that's going to be the kind of Messiah Jesus is going to be. After all, he's throwing people in hell, or he's throwing them in heaven. But John says, nope, that's not what John the Baptist said at all. He said that Jesus was going to be the kind of Messiah that was going to suffer for us. Sure, there are some Old Testament prophecies about that, such as the one from Isaiah in our Old Testament lesson day. It talks about the Messiah struggling. It talks about his difficult work. It talks about, in fact, how he was abhorrent. Now, how in the world can someone who uses the power of God to put down all evil and institute the reign of God in the earth, how can someone like that be abhorrent? Well, the apostles, after Jesus' death and resurrection, after the day of Pentecost, when they started understanding what John the Baptist was telling them, they understood that that was a reference to Jesus dying on the cross. That's a pretty abhorrent thing. And so John the Baptist was telling them exactly, not just the Messiah was coming, but he was telling them what kind of Messiah was coming. First, he was telling them it was all about the forgiveness of sins. For those who wanted forgiveness of sins from God, here was the one who is going to be able to give it to us. Here is the one who is going to be able to take away all of our sins, all of our misdeeds, all the ones we've ever did, all the ones we'll ever commit. John the Baptist was foretelling, here is the Messiah who can take away your sins. And he also tells us something else very interesting. He tells us that he's the one who's going to give us the Holy Spirit. And when John's telling us that Jesus is the one who is going to give us the Holy Spirit, he's telling us this is the one who's not only going to forgive our sins, but make sure that we're forever with God. Because by gifting us with the Holy Spirit, the presence of God is always with us. It's always with us when we're good and when we're bad, when we're doing the right thing and when we're doing the wrong thing, when we're serving God in the ways that Jesus has asked us to serve God, and even when we're doing things we shouldn't do. What we have in this promise from John the Baptist as he's out there in the wilderness telling us what kind of Messiah was coming, his promise is this one is going to give us the Holy Spirit, and it's not going to be upon whether we're good enough to receive the Holy Spirit. It's not going to be whether we can continue to be sinless so that we can retain the Holy Spirit. to me close to God. No, John the Baptist is telling us this Messiah is going to make it so that we are brought close to God forever. Never again will there be separation. Never again will we have to worry if God is working against us. Never again will we have to worry if God is looking to get us and to punish us. Never again will we have to search and wonder and go to great lengths to see where is God. Because John the Baptist tells us this Messiah is going to make sure that we are close to God forever. It's interesting, after hearing these things, the Apostle John and the Apostle Peter, they're so excited. They're so excited about what this Messiah is going to bring that they just have to go and tell their brothers about it. They've got to tell them the good news about this Messiah. And that's kind of an interesting thing about our gospel lesson. Kind of makes us think just a little bit, what really gets us excited? Because the people were all excited for a certain type of Messiah. And when they didn't get it, that's when they turned on Jesus and crucified him. They wanted the Messiah who was going to take over. They wanted the Messiah who was going to make everything right. They was going to that the Messiah that made sure justice reigned in the earth. They were wanted the Messiah to make sure that they would never struggle, they would never have any pains, they would never have any sorrow, they'd have abundance, they'd have riches, life would be easy, everything would be wonderful, better in fact than you could possibly imagine. That's the Messiah they were looking for. And yet, the Apostle John and the Apostle Andrew in our gospel lesson were excited about a very different Messiah. A Messiah who would come to take away our sins. A Messiah who would make sure that we were forever in a relationship with God. A Messiah who would be with us there when we were struggling and going through difficulties. This was not a Messiah that was going to promise us good things or wonderful things or abundance or riches or carefree life. In fact, this was a very different Messiah who was going to promise us struggles and pains and difficulties in life. But here was a Messiah that was promising, I'm going to be there with you. I'm going to be with you always in all of your struggles, in all of your pain. God loves you and God is working for you. And one day, the promise is that we will understand all of that. Kind of the question we have in our gospel lesson is, what kind of Messiah gets us excited? What kind of Messiah gets us excited the way we get excited about other things? Books, movies, sports teams. What kind of Messiah is it that we get excited about? Because the crowd was looking for one kind of Messiah. But those who understood who Jesus was, they were looking for a very different Messiah indeed. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for coming and giving us all the wonderful gifts that you've given us. And we pray that by your Spirit, you'll help us to follow you always. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
These are the days of your servant Moses.
be seated. Are there any announcements that anyone has? Well, it's cookie hour this Sunday, so please go downstairs and get some treats and some coffee. Any prayer requests?
I have a couple.
Yes.
Can you hear me? I'm going to be loud.
Good.
Leslie Henderson had open heart surgery Wednesday. She did very well. She had four blockages and they had to fix some other stuff. She'll be in the hospital for 5-6 days, something like that. And then she'll be staying at her daughter's in Detroit for a couple weeks. But everything went better than they wished. It was really good. Jim Lucius is on home dialysis at his home. He is not doing well. It's just not going smooth. So keep them in your prayers. He's having a hard time, a lot of toxins. They just can't get everything cleaned up and running smoothly with dialysis. And the little Madeline Strange that's in the bulletin, she's 8 months old with pneumonia and an enlarged heart. Ann Alexander is her great-grandmother, and she really has asked for us to pray for the little one. And Leslie and Jim's addresses are on the bulletin board across from the office if anybody wants to send notes.
And what else? Let us gather together as God's people and pray. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for coming and living as one of us and going through our struggles and our trials and our temptations, and yet meeting him with perfect grace and love and forgiveness and mercy. And we thank you that you have chosen through your sacrifice to impute to us your righteousness, to promise us your glory, and the promise that you have bound us in a relationship with God in a way that we can never be separated. We thank you, Lord God, for these gifts that you came to bring us. And we pray, Lord God, that your Spirit will work in us and work against the temptations and the ideas of the world, the hopes of the world that are against what you would have our hopes be and our goals. We pray that your Spirit will work in us and to build in us the kind of life and the kind of values that you came and lived among us. Pray, Lord God, that your Spirit will give us each day the strength to rise for whatever tasks that lie ahead of us, and give us the comfort to know that you are with us and that you promise us it will be okay through the tears and through the struggle, through the difficulties. Your presence, your power, and your love is going to make it okay. And even when we can't understand things and we don't see how things are working for good, you have promised us one day we will. And we thank you, Lord God, for that promise. We'd also like to pray this day, Lord God, for all of those who we know are going through struggles and difficulties. We know so many people that are going through physical ailments. So many people are afflicted with doubts, depression. We pray, Lord God, that you'll be with each one of these individuals that we've named, and so many that we don't know about. Now let us take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers, brothers. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Join me in the prayer of dedication. As the Lamb of God takes away the sins of the world, remember that we are baptized as a sign of new life. Accept these gifts, O God, which we offer as we recommit ourselves to ministry in Christ's name. May your Spirit empower us for the tasks that await, and the waters refresh us as we go forth to serve. Amen.
Thank you.
Grace and peace to you from him who was and is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Amen.